God is not mad at you. He's not upset with you. He's not angry with you. He doesn't despise you. I don't know what you did, but I do know that He has forgiven you. In fact, God loves you so much, and He misses spending time with you. If you can hear Him right now, He's saying, please come back to me. Please spend time with me. I love you. I miss you so much. Jesus is desperately trying to reach out for us in every way possible, breaking supernatural barriers to communicate with us. The biggest lie anyone could ever tell you, including Satan, is that God is upset with you. God doesn't want to see you right now. God doesn't want to use you because of what you've done. Or God knows your heart and He knows you're faking it. God is jealous for us, and He's jealous for the things that we put over Him every day. Not only is God madly in love with you, but He's in favor with you. In fact, God is smiling down on you right now, and Jesus is waiting with open arms.
With sorrow and mourning, and you have reason to mourn and be sorrowful. Nothing hurts like having something leave or change in your life. Even if it's a positive change, it's painful. Even if something negative leaves your life, it still requires a recalibration to try to figure out how does life work without this. But He said it's for your good. Paul comes along later and says all things work together for good. And even when it doesn't feel good, it can be for good. This is the transformative power of faith. It's for good. He said it's good that I'm ghosting you. It's good that I leave in physical form, because then I can give you in spiritual form. Then I can direct you from a deeper place. And God is working for you right now. But it might not feel good to you. But it doesn't have to feel good to you to be good for you. God is not going to build the rest of your life based on what you deserve. No, no, no. It is built on a much truer foundation than that. This foundation cannot be shaken. If the rain blows, if the winds blow, if the streams rise, if it beats against your house, it will have its foundation on the rock and it will stand firm. And that's what you've been learning in this season of your life. You've faced some rejection. Some doors have been shut. Some things have gone wrong. Some things have toppled. Some truths have been tested. But it's not about the furniture. It's about the foundation. God can move it all around, but how great a foundation, how firm a foundation is Jesus our Lord. If you know you've got the right foundation, give God a shout of praise right now.
So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the exits.
Listen, no matter who you are, I want to pray for you. I believe in the power of prayer. So please leave your prayer requests in my comments. And if you don't want to publicly share your prayer requests, just say,
what I have done to myself in some seasons of my life is I have held on to what was hurting me. How long are you gonna let a snake have free rent on your hand? It's just a question, because I get disappointed too. I get offended too. I get bitter too. One of my titles that I thought I shouldn't call this sermon was Bit Not Bitter. Because here's the way I was thinking about it. It can't kill you if it only penetrates the skin. It can't kill you if all it does is break the skin. It only kills you. The snake only kills Paul if he allows the venom to get in the vessel. That's the only way it stops you. That's the only way. It's a surface wound. God doesn't see you through the lens of your mistake.
maybe he sees you through the lens of his grace. Maybe when he looks at you, he sees the finished work of Jesus Christ. Have you ever thought about the fact that if they didn't make you, they can't define you? My maker is my mirror. God does something new in your life. At first, you don't know what to call it or how to receive it. And what keeps you from receiving it sometimes is your past and sometimes is your future. So they named it manna. What is it? What it is. What is it? I don't know. It's what it is. But I know one thing. I know I am. So whatever it is, I am is in the middle of it, working it out for a purpose that is beyond my human perspective. Here is the bread. Here is the bread.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. We live, we live, we live. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me into love for those around me. Oh, I will build my life upon your love and it's a firm foundation. I will put.
Might be on the brink of suicide while I'm preaching, and they can't understand, why am I feeling this depressed? Why am I going through this darkness? But what you might not know is that the size of the devil that is at your door indicates the size of the assignment that is on your life. Don't die here. This is a door. This is a door. This is a door. And the door that God opens, nobody can shut. Nobody can shut. And don't you let the devil use the door of what you don't know to fill your mind with hypothetical scenarios that cause your heart to close. Too young and too called to spend the rest of your life carrying around something that makes you ashamed and limited. God's hand is on your life. God's hand is, I know you may not have had Pastor Mickey to tell you that. You may not have had a great mom, or maybe you did, to raise you in church. Nobody may have ever told you this before I got here tonight. But I'm telling you, God sent me to tell you. God stirred me up to tell you. God put it in me to tell you. God's hand is on your life. See, you've always been called. That's why you've been a little weird. That's why you've been a little lonely. That's why you've been fighting in a conflict. That's why there are some things that you won't give into, but you struggle with.
Question is, what do you do when God bypasses what you want to give you what you need? The most obvious thing to do is to heal the man. But sometimes before God can do what is obvious and change your situation, he wants to work within you. So that when he changes your situation, you will be ready to receive it. In the Jewish mind, sin and suffering were highly connected. So it was often assumed that if you were suffering, it was because of sin. Jesus dispels this in John chapter 9, when the man born blind was declared to be not a sinner, but blind so that the works of God and the glory of God. I need to get ready for this thing. And sometimes we expect that when God announces a change in our life, it's going to be activated immediately. And we get confused when God says, it's your time, but he makes us wait our turn. And sometimes God is doing things. It was on that day that David was announced to be a king, but it would be many years later that he would wear the crown. You know, when you give your life to Christ, in a moment you're saved, in a moment you're forgiven, in a moment you're cleansed, in a moment you're redeemed. All of those things are true of you immediately. But all of the changes that those new realities are meant to produce in your life happen not immediately, but gradually.
I have an appointment. Come on, I'm preaching to somebody because you have an appointment. Now, what happens in our hearts is that we get disappointed. We get disappointed in the way that God does certain things. We get disappointed in the people that don't help us along the way. But just because you're disappointed in people, don't jump off the ship and drown in the sea. Did you hear me? Just because people let you down, don't give up on God who never will. Just because you lost a job, don't stop trusting that God is my provider. Jehovah Jireh, that's still his name. Jehovah Rafika, he's still a healer. I'm still gonna get there. I'm still going to Rome. I got an appointment. Is what the Lord says. Everybody say it. This is what the Lord says. What did I come to church to hear? What the Lord says. What do I want to fill my heart with? What the Lord says. What do I want my kids to believe? What the Lord says. What am I building my life on that can't be shaken with a storm? What the Lord says. What has the power to defeat and uproot every lie I believe? What the Lord says. What am I steering my life according to? What the Lord says. What has the final say over what happens to me in this season of my life? What the Lord says. What has divine power to demolish strongholds and defeat every devil in hell? What the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. I heard what you said, Benadad, but this is what the Lord says.
Nothing has changed about God. With so many unstable things that can knock you off balance in life. Let me just stand behind this big sturdy pulpit for a moment and remind you that every bit of that is still true. No matter what you've been through, listen here. No matter what the locusts have eaten, no matter what time has slipped through your fingers that you wasted because you couldn't get it together, it's still true. And I emphasize the word still. It's still true. You're still going to do it. You're still going to make it. You're still going to fulfill God's purpose for your life. You're still. Oh, man. The next one got me. You're still chosen.
I will stand by you. I will help you through. When you've done all you can do, and you can't cope, I will dry your eyes. I will find your fire. I will hold you tight, and I won't let.
54 verse 17, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. It did not say it would not push you back. It did not say that it would knock you down. It said it shall not prosper. It's not going to take me out. I may get wounded. I may get bruised. I may get pushed back. but I'm coming back. I may get knocked down, but I'm getting back up. I may get pushed up against a wall, but I'm coming out fighting. Because look, I'm going to tell you something. This armor right here can only prevent so much. Then you got to get thicker armor. It's time for us to be soldiers of the Lord. Amen. And fight the good fight of faith. Amen. And stand firm. Amen. And build our armor up thicker, because the enemy is coming at full strength. And it's time to build the armor of God up and say, no, you're not going to take my house. You're not going to take my kids. You're not going to take my neighbor. We're going to stand and fight the good fight of faith.
Eyes of the Lord are going to and fro all over the earth, searching to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Let's work backwards. Your heart is fully committed to God. That's the space that you've given him. How much space have you given God to work in your life? Or do you keep secret corners for yourself? God, I'm going to trust you with this much, but not that much. God, I'm going to give you this part, but not that part. God, I'm going to let you in here, but I'm going to fake it over here. God, I'm going to go this far, but if this happens, I'm going to start pulling back. Isaiah said, don't hold back, because the part of your heart that you don't give God becomes enemy held territory. And that's where doubt takes over. And that's where fear takes over. And that's why you can't seem to get your mind straight, because you gave God's territory to your enemy. But today we came to take it back. Here's my heart, Lord. Some people rejected you at points in your life, and you thought it was about you, but it was not about you. They were passing on to you an insecurity that they carried within themselves. So be very careful, because even your parents can give you a secondhand story about who you are that does not align with the full potential of what God made you to be. So they'll say stuff like this. Well, nobody in our family ever did that before. Well, that must mean God left it for me to do. I'm a barrier breaker. I'm a line crosser. I'm a crazy so-and-so, and I might just do it.